Nowadays, much is spoken about manned missions to Mars, and maybe even a future colony on the Red Planet. Are we ever going to live in space? What do you think? Well, when I was small, I used to read books by Isaac Asimov. He wrote many stories about how the advancement of technology would allow humanity to explore and colonize space in just a few decades. It was not just me. Since the 1950s, science fiction has been selling the idea of space exploration. Generations grew up believing that humanity would soon be able to colonize space. Many books were written on the subject, but it never really happened. Apart from a few manned missions to our closest satellites and the construction of a small space station in lower orbit, not much happened. It doesn't seem that we are much closer to explore space than we were in the 1960s. Before, NASA was selling this idea, and now we have private companies selling the same idea. Elon Musk has been promoting the idea of building a self-sustainable colony on Mars with 1 million inhabitants in the next few decades. It looks very amazing, but it will never work. Why? The first problem in colonizing space is that we don't have access to the higher dimension where more evolved beings live. According to the Vedas, there are living beings living comfortably on most planets of the universe, but they have bodies adapted to the conditions there. We have bodies adapted to the environment we find in our own planet, and it's very difficult for us to live anywhere else. Not only it's very difficult to leave our planet due to the gravity, but even when we finally get into space, we see only inhospitable environments, extremes of temperature and other hazards. Unless one is capable of elevating his consciousness to gain access to the higher dimensions of the universe, he will find only dangers and privations outside our planet. Apart from the philosophical aspects of the celestial status of the different planets of our universe and the existence of different dimensions, points we have been exploring in our previous videos, there is another very simple, logical and down-to-earth question: economics. Why don't we build colonies at the bottom of the ocean? It's not because it's not technically possible, but it's just because it's too expensive. Science fiction novels are always based on leaps of faith. Some new revolutionary technology, like an inexhaustible source of fuel, or a cheap way to lift up materials to space, or some easy way to build giant space stations with materials produced from thin air. However, when we examine the real challenges of sending materials to space and creating livable conditions for humans in space or in other planets, one sees that although it's not an unsolvable problem, it's just too problematic and too expensive. The International Space Station, which started being built in 1993, cost about $160 billion. And this was just for a very small station built in low orbit, very close to our planet. The same station built in an orbit around Mars, for example, would cost several times more. And if it would be built on the surface of the Red Planet, it would cost even more. Some speculate that the cost of spaceships and space stations can drop dramatically with the economy of scale. According to these sources, if we start producing it in mass, they may cost as little as a commercial jet. Well, not really. Maybe one could build a space probe at the cost of a small plane, but the real problem is the enormous amount of fuel necessary to put it into space and transport it to distant planets. The cost of the probe may go down if one mass produces it, but the fuel to put it in orbit, as well as the rockets and other disposable materials, will not become any less expensive. The Mars Curiosity rover, for example, weighs about 889 kilos. It cost $2.47 billion to send it to Mars, which equals $2.78 million per kilogram. Just imagine, if you would be living on Mars and your mother would want to send you a small package with some presents, it would cost $2.78 million to send it there. After solving the initial problem of sending a few humans to Mars, together with some small habitat and supplies, another problem would be how to maintain them there. Imagine the amount of food, water, clothes, and other products you use during your life. An average human eats about 35 tons of food during his life. He also needs water, clothes, and other supplies. To live in an inhospitable environment like Mars, one would also need space suits, radiation shields, sources of energy, vehicles, and many specialized tools, apart from the habitat he lives on. Unfortunately, there is no Walmart or Amazon on Mars. Therefore, all of these will need to be sent from Earth at a cost of $2.78 million per kilogram. Most of us don't make so much money in our entire lifetimes. How many people on the planet would be rich enough to live on Mars at such cost? I don't think any. The cost of maintaining a small colony on Mars would be on the scale of trillions of dollars. Worse than that, colonies in space will always have to be supplied from Earth. One may be able to recycle water and produce some food on Mars by bringing some soil and toast from Earth. It may also be possible to produce some water from gases in the atmosphere or mine it from underground sources. But what about everything else? How to produce a computer or a hover on Mars? These things will always have to be brought from Earth at an exorbitant cost. The colony will never be self-sufficient, and as soon as the interest on it would start to wane, people will not want to continue spending so much money on it, and the project would have to be abandoned. What would happen to the people struggling to live there at this point would be a good question. Apart from that, there is another problem. Life in space will be always miserable. Just like in the ISS, people living in space or in space colonies will always be forced to live in cramped and uncomfortable conditions, drinking their own urine in the form of recycled water, cultivating vegetables in their own stool, suffering from the harmful effects of solar radiation and other hazards, and living in constant alert in inhospitable conditions. The record of permanence in space was set in 2016 by Valery Polyakov, who spent a total of 437 days in the ISS. However, the environment is so harsh that most astronauts are not capable of staying nearly as much in space, and these are people who are rigorously selected and trained for this kind of mission. To think that a normal person would be able to live in such harsh conditions for all his life is a great leap of faith. Even if it would be possible, only a crazy fellow would voluntarily choose so. Human bodies are just not made to survive in outer space. We have bodies that are capable of living in the environment we were made to live on our own planet. A human being who will try to live on Mars or any other planet will just condemn himself to a very short and miserable life. It's actually possible to travel in outer space and to visit other planets, but the process to do so is to elevate one's consciousness and use the appropriate process to acquire a suitable type of body to live there. One who does so will attain a body capable of not only living in a different atmosphere, but to experience the environments and interact with the inhabitants there. This is what really means to travel to other planets. Compared to that, the harsh conditions in cramped, unsafe space probes constructed at an exorbitant cost look very childish. We can't even take care of the problems we have right here on our own planet. What to say about creating utopic societies on other planets?
Krishna, 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 Krishna.